examination of eye. So what do I mean by examination of eye is when a patient comes to you, the OP, and you are present in the ophthalmology department, these are all the set of information which you need to know to attend to that patient. So first of all, you need to know what are the symptoms you're going to present with, what are the various signs you're going to look out for, and what are the different investigations which you can do for these cases. So first of all, moving into the symptoms, the most common symptom a patient is going to present with is loss of vision or altered vision. So they're going to have either a diminution of vision, which can either be sudden or gradual with or without pain. So examples of sudden painful loss of vision conditions are your acute congestive glaucoma and iridocyclitis. Your sudden painless loss of vision conditions are your retinal vessel related pathologies, like your central retinal artery occlusion, central retinal vein occlusion, and retinal detachment. Your gradual onset of loss of vision with pain would be your chronic iridocyclitis and glaucoma. Your gradual painless loss of vision would be cataract and chorioretinal degeneration. So these are all examples which you need to know. They might ask you in this in your VIVAS the first question. So moving on, the patient might have diplopia or double vision and photophobia, colored halos, floaters, visual field defects, refractive errors. So these are all the symptoms, and I have not mentioned in which disease conditions these symptoms are present. We will talk about them and we talk about those diseases. Okay. So moving on, redness or congestion of the conjunctiva or sclera, or basically red eye. So there are two types of congestion, conjunctival and ciliary or scleral. So you can see the difference between them is this is mostly marked in the fornix, bright red and well defined. This scleral will be, or ciliary congestion will be mostly in the limbal area. And these are all branched like this, and this will be more parallelly arranged. So those are the small things which you need to know about redness. Then secretion, either there can be over secretion, example epiphora, it's also known as epiphora, and under secretion is known as dry eye. So, and finally, they might have some kind of eyeball disturbances. So eyeball disturbances can be of three types: something involving the eyelid or the gaze, or they might have nystagmus. So the conditions affecting the eyelid will be any altered position or altered direction, or unable to close the eyelid. So altered position is ptosis, then altered direction is entropion or ectropion, and unable to close is lagoptormos. These are all the various commonly presenting symptoms in ophthalmology. So the various signs you are going to see are, I am going to go in order from anterior to posterior. So first of all, you need to look at the head position. So if there is any problem with the extraocular muscles, or if there is ptosis, you can pick it up as soon as you look at the head position. Then facial asymmetry, in case of Bell's palsy or facial nerve palsy, you will see there will be asymmetry of face. Then in when you look at the eyebrow and you don't see much hair, you can suspect leprosy, because in leprosy there's a loss of eyebrow hair. And in eyelids, as I said before, it can be either an entropion, ectropion, ptosis, or blepharitis. And then moving on to eyelashes, you can have madarosis, which is absence of or very little eyelashes, trichiasis, dystichiasis, entropion, ectropion. So all of that is represented in this picture over here. So this is the normal eyelid. So you can see trichiasis, it's inverted over here. And this is dystichiasis, where both it's inverted in both ways. Then entropion and ectropion. So all these are pathological conditions. Then moving on to lacrimal sac. So there might be some kind of swelling over the lacrimal sac, and when you see some kind of swelling, you are supposed to apply pressure over it and check if there's any regurgitation of fluid. And that would be the basic thing of lacrimal sac. Then moving into the eye proper ocular examination. So first of all, conjunctiva, two parts are there, your bulbar and palpebral conjunctiva. So if this is your eyeball, and then this will be your palpebral conjunctiva, and this will be your bulbar conjunctiva. So in a bulbar conjunctiva, there can either be edema, some kind of growth like pterygium or pinguicula or pseudopterygium or tryptan. All of those can be present, and then you can see some kind of bite out spot, which is a classical sign of vitamin A deficiency. So that will be in the bulbar. In the palpebral, you can either see congestion, foreign body, follicles, papillae, and then cobblestone appearance, and then membranous adhesions. All those things you can see in the palpebral conjunctiva, and they're very, very important in helping us understand what type of conjunctivitis it is. So conjunctivitis can be either bacterial, fungal, protozoal, so or viral. So it's going to help us in determining what kind of conjunctivitis it is. Then we move one layer behind, that would be your cornea. So this is the cornea, and then surrounding that will be your sclera. So your green is your cornea, and your blue is your sclera. So in cornea, you're supposed to know the curvature and transparency. So abnormal curvature can either be keratoconus, which is cone-shaped cornea, or keratoglobus, which is round, extra protruding cornea. And then transparency, there might be some kind of opacification present in the cornea, or some kind of adhesions, or striate keratitis, which is a common post-op complications of cataract surgery if you don't use adequate viscoelastic. Then moving on to the sclera, so you can see scleral congestion with the lot of vessels present over sclera. You can see scleritis or episcleritis, very common condition. You see it as a red eye. And anterior chamber, so your anterior chamber is the region from the cornea to the lens. Your anterior segment will be your cornea till your iris. Iris to lens will be a posterior segment of anterior chamber. Something which you need to know, which was mentioned in the anatomy of eye in the previous video. So the anterior chamber is supposed to know two things which might be present. So one is depth. It can either be shallow, deep, shallow, or deep, or normal. So how do you check this is using iris shadow. So there's a lot of confusion amongst people when it comes to iris shadow. So when you put the light over here, the light source is coming this side, and you can see the shadow in this here. So this is usually you won't be able to see in normal conditions. In a shallow anterior chamber, you'll be able to see the iris shadow properly. So if you see someone with a shallow anterior chamber, please do make it a point to check the iris shadow. Then there might be some abnormal contents present in the anterior chamber, like pus, blood, lens matter, or foreign body. So that can also be on seen on examination. Then moving on to the iris. So iris will be you need to know the color of the iris. So it can be either muddy or white atrophic patches may be present. So about all of this in detail, the pathology behind this, I'll talk when I talk about the iris. Then there might be adhesions, that is adhesion between the lens and the iris, or iris and cornea. Those things you need to know. And there's something called as iridodonesis, which is tremors of iris in dark room with oblique illumination. You will see movement of this iris. So moving on to pupil. So normal size of pupil is 2 to 4 millimeters, and it can either be very small meiotic or very large mitriatic. And anisochoria is unequal size of two pupils. And then when it comes to pupil, you need to check the light reflexes. There are two light reflexes, direct and indirect. Indirect light reflex is due to the interneurons present between the edinguvial best ball nucleus. This was also mentioned in the previous video about the anatomy of the eye. So moving on to the lens, you need to know about the color of the lens and Purkinje images. So the various colors of the lens are jet black, which is in FAQ or normal, grayish, pearly white, brown, black, yellowish, all are cataract lens where it has started opacifying. So gray should be your immature, pearly white mature, brown black would be hyper mature, and yellow should be your hyper mature, which has shrunken in size, infected hypermature or Morgagni cataract. And then Purkinje images are something which you see like reflection on the surface, clear transparent surface. So you'll see on the cornea and the lens. So you'll see two Purkinje images in one transparent surface. So on cornea you'll see two, in lens you'll see two. So that's four normally, or in pseudophakia you see four. And in mature cataract, the posterior part of the lens, that Purkinje image won't be seen. So you'll see three Purkinje images, and in aphakia you'll see only two Purkinje images. So moving on. So all of these were just inspection with a light source. Then you can do palpation. So in palpation, you need to check the intraocular pressure using digital tonometry, or digital tonometry is very inaccurate. You need to be very experienced to know if the intraocular pressure is normal. So usually what they do is they send them to check the IOP using Schiotz tonometry. The other types of tonometers available are your implantation tonometers. Examples are your Goldman and Perkin, and there's the latest one known as Tonopen. So other than that, there are various examinations which you can do, which will be your slit lamp examination and gonioscopy. So slit lamp examination is just magnified inspection of whatever is happening in the eye. Nothing more to talk about it as such, because I've told so much in detail during the inspection part. It'll be more evident when you use a slit lamp examination. And gonioscopy is done where you examine the angle structures. So this is the angle structures which you're going to see over there. So you have something called Schwaberg's line. So that this line is known as Schwaberg's line. That is the line where the Descemet membrane goes to the angle, and then you see this trabecular meshwork, and then the canal of Schlemm, and then the ciliary body. So this part you're going to visualize using gonioscopy. Very useful in glaucoma like conditions, glaucomatous conditions. So whatever I've spoken now is only about the anterior segment of the eye until the lens. So the retina, the visual acuity, then the fundus examination, and then those things will be dealt in the next video. So please do check it out. Thank you.